From New York City, it's Rock Hard with Jay Conroy.
We're here with Dani G from 1000 Mods. Thanks for being on the show, man. I really appreciate it.
You're welcome, dude. I'm so happy to meet you and to have a conversation with you.
Yeah, you guys got a great band. You know, I came on to you recently. Now, you've basically been around since what, 2006, 2007, yeah. The band was originally formed?
Yeah, like the summer of 2006. Yeah, like June of 2006, something like that.
And how did you guys get together? Did you guys all know each other? How did that happen?
We've known each other since we were kids. You know, we were spending our times of vacation together since we were like 5 years old. So we are very good friends from our childhood. And as the years passed by, we fell in love with the same kind of music, you know, punk rock, rock, metal and stuff. And at some point we decided that each one grabs an instrument. And then the one thing led to another and we found ourselves 2006 and made the 1000 Mods.
Your latest album, which is out right now, Youth Of Dissent.
Yeah.
So the band has kept pretty busy getting music out. And you guys are on the road, it seems like, constantly. You do a lot of touring. Yes. You're a huge band in Greece, is that correct?
Yeah, it's pretty good, yeah.
I've like seen some footage of you playing in Greece, and it's a big audience.
Yeah,
they know all the words to your song.
Yeah. I mean, now the rock scene in Greece for some years now, like 10 years now, it's big, like. We gather in our shows like 4,000 people here in Greece, so it's good.
Yeah. That is really good.
Yeah, it's very good.
So you the rock scene you say is good in Greece. What is like the up and coming scene like in Greece for rock bands?
Now I don't know because of the virus, but before that like. Many independent underground bands, like rock bands, alternative bands, metal. The metal scene is big here. Also, we have a huge band called Rotting Christ. I don't know if you know them. It's like a black metal band, which is worldwide known. They were the first, actually, who put out extreme music from Greece out in the world. And they've been touring since the 90s, so they are the first. And yeah, I think this will continue because we have a lot of good and unique bands that coming out from here now.
So how long was it before the band got out of Greece and started going to other countries? Because you guys have become very well known in Europe.
Actually, our first tour was after the release of our first album in 2011. So we released a Superband Vacation and the next month, for the first time ever, we hit Europe for a 30 days, a month European tour. And we've booked it all by ourselves, so we didn't know what to expect at all. It
was now, like, how did you make that happen? You know, being a brand new band, how did you get people to agree to book you?
I guess it was like, okay, we sent some emails to the promoters for each country, it's a club. And they said, okay, if you want to play, you can play. Nobody knew about us, but they let us play. So they didn't care, actually.
Right.
Yeah. They just wanted to fit the day for a band. So,
right.
Yeah. Something like that.
Okay, so outside of Greece, what are your biggest markets? Where else are you very well known?
It's good in Europe, in Germany, in France.
Germany's huge, yeah.
Yeah. It's like in Switzerland, in Belgium. Like, I remember our last gig in Belgium 2 years ago was in a place. It held like, I think it was like sold out. It was like 900 people, if I remember. But it was insane, man. It was insane. It was the most punk rock gig we've ever made. Like, it was, the crowd was amazing. In the States were also great. I mean,
I was going to ask you about the States. I know you've toured a little bit in the States. You've done, you've done a lot of stuff on the West Coast.
Yes.
In the States. In the East Coast, from my research, and correct me if I'm wrong, you've played Orlando, Florida. You played in Georgia, Virginia, Washington, D.C., Philadelphia, and here in New York and Brooklyn at St. Vitus.
Yes. Yeah, that's correct.
Now,
actually, we did the whole 1 month tour in the USA. It's like we did the whole circle, East Coast, West Coast, North and South. And we did three shows in Canada also. So it was like a month of road tripping and playing every day.
Now, so, did people know who you were when you got here?
Yeah, they did. And we got like, I think we got like three or four sold out shows. I don't remember now where. It was in Los Angeles for sure at the Regis. I think it was in Seattle.
Seattle doesn't surprise me because you guys are right up Seattle's alley. Yeah.
It was like one or more or two shows that were sold out. But yeah, people knew about us.
Good.
And yeah, that was insane. I mean, St. Vitus was like, I think St. Vitus was sold out.
The thing that you have, the band has a very distinctive sound. And a lot of that, from what I understand, is you guys are into vintage gear and analog recording.
Yes, we try to.
Talk to me a little bit about that.
So, as kids, and when we were watching our biggest band, like Black Sabbath, you know, the video clip from Iron Man and Paranoid, they're using vintage orange amps.
Yeah.
It was like we always wanted, because we were looking and we were listening to our inspirations from the 70s and from bands like Black Sabbath, from MC5, the Stooges, Ramones, and Blue Cheer. Like all of them used that equipment. So we wanted to use vintage equipment in order to sound like them. But we've never done that. We didn't sound like them. But yeah, we loved it.
Your band is described as psychedelic stoner rock. Is that accurate?
No. We always used to say that we play rock music. Whether it's heavy, whether it's psychedelic, whether it's like it's rock and roll based. So yeah, psychedelic stoner rock. I don't like that.
Yeah, and you know, it's funny because a lot of bands I talk to that put down some sort of genre, when I ask them about it, they all basically answer the same way you just did. They're like, it's rock and roll. And that's how I look at it. Like,
it's just, you know, rock and roll.
Yeah. Because the first song that I started playing on my show off of there was So Many Days.
Yeah.
Because I love that song. I love the whole album. But So Many Days, I was like, this is a great song. And then I started playing Pearl quite a bit.
Yeah.
And Lucid. So those are like probably my three main favorite tracks off of that album.
Thanks, man.
Now, how does the writing process go with you guys? Does somebody lay down a riff and then you add the vocals? How does that all come about?
It depends, you know, like because we have four records now, and each record is recorded in a different way, in a different studios with different producers and all that stuff. And that goes exactly the same with how we write songs. It depends. I mean, it all starts with a jam, I guess. We gather to make rehearsals, and there's a jam, there's a riff that pops up at some point, and we like it, and then we start building up to that riff or that drum beat or whatever. So yeah, it usually starts with a jam, like. But there are some points that maybe one of us has a riff that brings to the rehearsal, and everybody else likes that. So we try to jam over that specific riff. So there comes a song, and then maybe I have a melody. So it depends. It depends on the mood, actually. Yeah.
And do you write all the vocals?
Most of them, especially in the last record, Youth of Dissent, we all four contributed to the vocals because I wanted everybody else to write what they were thinking so I can sing it. So it's like a four-piece thing coming together.
And where do your vocals come from? What is it you are all writing about?
Most of the times, it's very personal. It's about things I see in my daily routine, the streets, on the subway. It's like from a book I read or a movie I saw. I like a line, so I'm thinking this line a lot, and more often. So I have a pattern, so I can write some lyrics. But mostly, it's personal and. With everything that can be in the personal, from social things, society things, political and emotional for me, personal stuff. Mm.
Yeah, it's got to come from emotion.
Yeah, something like that.
I think it's great that you know, you had the other three band members help contribute vocals on this last record. And something I meant to touch on before is I think it's great that you guys have been friends since you were little kids, because that makes for a really tight band.
It is.
And I don't just mean musically, I mean friendship wise. It's not like you put an ad out, hey, I'm looking for a bass player, I'm looking for a guitar player. The fact that you guys all grew up together, you know, that makes it really special.
And the important thing is that we didn't become friends after we made the band. We were friends, and that's why we made the band. So
yeah, that's what I mean. Yeah.
Important thing for us, no, because I mean, we've got our teeth together, we've been together like 14 years now, so each day, and we had our bad times, we had our good times, but we're all together, so it's like a family.
Yeah. Where did you come up with the name 1000 Mods?
Actually, 1000 Mods is it's a funny translation of the place where we come from. Mm-hmm. The place where we come from, it's like it's in the country. It's like 1 hour drive from the capital, Athens. It's called Heliomodi. So the translation, 1000 in Greek is Helia, and Mod is Modi. So it's Heliomodi. It's the name of the town we come from, actually. So it's 1000 Mods. We were wasted one day. We were young. We were like 18 years old. And we were thinking of what name should we give to the band. And that's the first thing we came up. Our guitarist, George, came up with.
It's a great band name. And band name is...
It's weird, but yeah, it's great. It's good. It's good.
Yeah, it is weird, but it's great because once you say it to someone, 1000 Mods, it sticks in your head. You don't have to go, what was the name of that band? And you know, another thing too with the internet is it's easy to find. I know some bands that have named themselves things that if I type in 1000 Mods, you guys come up. It's that simple.
And okay, there's fun
other bands that it's like I type it in and I gotta look for them because you know the name could mean something else, or it's the same as this or the same as that. So especially in the days of the internet, you know, you type in 1000 Mods, you're not going to get anything else but your band that comes up.
And the funny story is that when we started the band back in 2006, most people were thinking that we were from the Mod movement from England, the Who and all that stuff, and they were thinking that we were going to play like a more rock and roll is like rockabilly stuff.
Right.
Yeah. But yeah.
Which makes sense, you know, but yeah, I mean, when I heard the band, I just don't know. I didn't really think of that because I heard the band and it right away, it was hard. It was rocking. So the album cover on your latest album, what's that all about?
Excuse me, sorry, it was a bad connection.
What is that all about? It's like you have this child on the album cover, or
actually, this child is a mugshot.
Is a what?
It's a mugshot.
What is that?
A mugshot, like this child was he was arrested back in the 50s in the United States.
Really?
Yeah. And it's a mugshot and...
a mugshot. Now I get it. Okay.
My enunciation maybe is not so good.
That's okay. And mine might not be great for you. So no, your enunciation is very good. So,
Yeah. It's a mugshot. And we tried to... Because first came the title, like Youth of Dissent. And we wanted to put some strong image in the front cover. So it was like an idea of the art worker. It's a very talented guy. His nickname is Tind, T-I-N-D. So he came up with that idea, with that picture and the girl behind making the silence. So it's like a statement, I guess. It's like maybe the society tells you to shut the fuck up, but you don't have to shut the fuck up. You have you have to fight for your rights.
Now, do you happen to know who that kid is?
No.
Just a random mugshot that you guys found.
It's free from rights. So yeah, it's like a much, actually, maybe the guy who did that knows, but he didn't tell us, I don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's great. That's a really good story. I'm glad I asked because I was not expecting that at all.
Yeah. And if you see the full picture, this kid has the placket with name got.
But
the guy got the picture, so it's like only the face.
Gotcha. That's great. That's good to know. Okay. So the album is good. You're doing really well on the streaming sites.
Good.
Many do you? Are you aware of how many streams that you have out there?
I'm not so sure. I know that on Spotify we have like 144,000 listeners, something like that, I guess. But I don't know about the streams. I think maybe our song Vidage from our first album has like 5 million streams, something like that. And in YouTube it's like 10 million, like.
I saw the YouTube. You guys do very, very well on YouTube, which is good, you know. Yeah. And the thing that sucks is, like, you don't make the kind of money, you know. Like, I look at streams because I come from the 70s, and I'll be like, nobody ever sold this amount of records, you know. And now these bands are actually getting millions upon millions of streams and not making the money that they should. So they, you know, they got to do it on the road.
Yeah, that's what I was gonna say. We're doing it from the road, so that's why we're playing, because we like it, and because we don't, you know, that the thing is on the road, on the gigs. That's it.
I mean, unfortunately, with the internet and streaming, that has become the way that, you know, it's a business, and that's how bands have to do business now, playing live and selling merchandise.
I know, but in fact, we don't actually pay so much attention also to the streams. Like, if it pops out, we see that. We don't sit and look how we've done this month or whatever. We don't really care. So it's all about the music, man. If it's good, somebody will listen. Like, somebody like you will listen it, and we have a conversation now in the other side of the world. So that's the most important thing.
Well, you know, as much as I like, you know, classic rock, you know, from the 70s, I like a lot of different kinds of music. I mean, I'm a rock and roller, but I like a lot of different kinds of music. And, you know, for me, doing a radio show, I'm on a few different radio stations here, and it's internet, so you can hear it all over the world. And the last thing I wanted to do was be a classic rock station. You know, because it's like everybody's heard it, you know? So I play Aerosmith, I play AC/DC, I play Led Zeppelin, but I play deep tracks. I don't play what you're going to hear, you know, the commercial side of it. Then I spend a lot of time looking for new bands, you know? Well, who's up and coming? Who's out there now that I haven't heard of? You know, because in the 70s, unless you got on the radio, there was no internet, nobody ever heard of you. Now there's so many bands on the internet that you really have to search through. So I'll get on Spotify, which is how I found you guys, and I'll sit there and I'll listen to 30, 40 songs in a row. and bless you. And, you know, I'll be like, you know, I'll listen to the beginning, and if it doesn't keep me, I'll fast forward into, I want to hear the singer, and then I take it from there. Some bands right away, you know, from Love at First Listen, which is what I found with your band. I was like, right away, I like these guys. I was like, okay. Then I'll write down all the bands that I like. Then I'll start researching the bands, and, you know, find out, okay, where are these guys from, you know, because, you know, I've read very little about you guys in the American press. Like, I don't see a lot about you guys in rock and roll press in America.
Yeah, I know. We were about to do that, but the whole thing with a new record, but the whole thing with the COVID situation got us back. So fortunately, when this whole situation will get better, we'll do that also in the United States. So more and more people will know about us, something like that.
Yeah, well, more people are going to know about you now, because that's what I like to do. I like to find these bands that aren't getting written up in American press.
And we want to thank you for that, and for having this conversation now, because not so many people do that nowadays, you know. Like,
you're welcome.
Not so many people do that, man.
Like, I love to do this. I love to talk to bands.
I can see that. And thanks so much.
You're welcome. So. Great talking to you. And
nice to meet you
next time. Nice to meet you too, man.
Take care, man. Take care. Be safe.
Bye-bye. All right. Bye.
Thanks. Bye.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Bye.